I think wisdom is a different thing from being simply intelligent. I think that wisdom is where emotion and thought come together, you know? And I would say that if we all open ourselves up emotionally, let's say, for example, with the aid of psychedelics, because that's what they do, is they show you the core sort of emotional landscape that is within all of us. And that often severs for people who are too sort of trapped within logic. It severs them from that kind of loop and opens them up to this wider thing. Well, I would just say that for us to move forward with wisdom, it could very well be employing great technology as an ally to heal our relationship with the world.
Hey everyone, this is your host Yoshino, and you are listening to episode number 65 of Artists Decoded. This is the Martin Wittfooth and Sergio Barrale episode, interviewed by my boy Justin Hopkins. So I really like this episode. There was a point in the episode when Sergio was talking about not letting bad things frustrate you and not letting things overcome you. You know, the more that I hang out with Sergio, because he recently moved to Los Angeles, the more that I get to know Sergio, I see just the sincerity of him as a human being and, you know, how he lives his life. And yeah, I just think he's a really solid guy. I think you guys will like this episode. Martin and Sergio are both really good friends. They're probably best friends. You can tell the love that they have for each other. Yeah, this is a great episode. Great conversation. They talk about psychedelics. They talk about the ego. I remember there was a point when they were talking about lessening your ego. You know, I think when you lessen your ego and you actually see yourself from an outsider's point of view, you can really determine what needs to be changed about yourself from a very egoless point of view. And I think when you can truly approach life from an outsider's point of view and being able to improve yourself, even marginally, you can really make great progress in your life. And, you know, I really try to do just like little things every single day just to improve on my life. And when you look back on these things, I think you can really tell how much different your life is. And at the end of the day, when you want to change certain things about yourself, you have to put things into perspective and you have to understand that little changes lead to big changes, and the minutia of change will really determine who you're going to be in the future. So when I look at it, it's like I have an idea of where I want to go and what I want to be and who I want to be, but I have to put it in perspective and say I need to do things slowly and baby steps, and baby steps will eventually get you to where you want to be in the future. I look at training that way. I look at martial arts that way. I look at learning things that way, you know, reading books and trying to understand, you know, the nuances and the intricacies of my own life, and then applying those things into different outlets. So here's the episode with Martin Wittfooth and Sergio Barrale. I hope you all enjoy it. If you'd like to donate to the cause, which is Artists Decoded, please go to our website, www.artistsdecoded.com. There's a donate link, which brings you to our PayPal. And if you don't want to donate, that's totally fine. You can go to our iTunes and leave us a shining 5-star review. And that would make me super happy. And I love everyone. Everyone's been reaching out to me and it's just been a really great experience. And I love doing this podcast. So I'm going to continue to do it just because I love it. And I love all you guys and gals. So here it is, the episode with Justin Hopkins interviewing Sergio Barrale and Martin Wittfooth for Artists Decoded.
Hey, if you find this phone, call this number.
Right.
And this is the text I get from him from that phone today. Goes, I'll never give this phone back, pussy. Vote for Trump. Yeehaw. And I go, that has to be it's got to be Sergio.
Yeah.
But I started getting pissed. I started getting so fucking pissed. So I text his dad's phone. I'm like, hey, can you have Sergio call me? And you call, and it's like, was that you? And you just start laughing. It's like, all right, well.
Oh, by the way, I started recording. I started recording, and I'm keeping that in.
Dude, please. Yeah.
All right.
So, are you guys cool? You guys all good? I know I just sprung this on you.
No, totally, man.
No, yeah, we're good.
Yeah, good, cool.
I love it. Yeah, go with the flow, yeah.
So, like, I guess we should start.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Cheers, 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 cheers.
I guess, like, that's actually a good place to start. So, you guys kind of had a crazy, well, especially Sergio coming in. Oh, by the way, I'm sitting here. I'm Justin Hopkins. I'm sitting here with Sergio Barrale. Is that correct?
That's
how you
correct.
Say it? Yeah. And Martin Wittfooth.
Yeah.
You guys had a pretty, or at least Sergio had a pretty traumatic trip getting out here.
Yeah.
Care to elaborate a little bit?
What does it feel like when you're driving a car and it starts to burst into flames?
Dude, I don't know. You tell me.
Yeah, it's so crazy. It's transformative because you feel like there's not really much in life sometimes that I think I can control. I mean, I definitely can't control the situations that happen around me.
Right.
And this was such a good teaching in that it very much said, hey, you could only control your brain. It's the only thing you can control. You can control how you react to it. I don't think you can control what brain chemicals you're born into this meat suit with, or if you're born in Rwanda in the 90s. But you can control your behavior to some extent, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, biologically, some would argue about that, right?
Right.
But I found that it's been a good teaching to lose a lot of my possessions in life because I guess I'm worth it, you know?
Sure.
I'm that much more worth it. That's all.
Yeah. So give us the setup, though.
Yeah, explain to the listeners happened. We yeah.
I was driving a car, burst into flames.
Yeah.
And,
oh, yeah. All right, setup. Is my parents are in the back. We're driving across country because
from New York.
Yeah, I picked him up in Jersey, and my dad's bucket list is to have a road trip, and he wants to be in the Grand Canyon with his son. You know, right. For like the last time. Hope not. But
oh, geez, yeah.
So and then it just so happened that you know, I got a Huntington Beach Art Center exhibit that I'm part of that happened at the same time. So it's all kind of like fortuitous, like, okay, cool, we'll try and make that exhibit.
Right.
Then, and I mean, before all of that, like Marty was going to be out here anyways, which was cool. So anyways, driving across America. Brand new Subaru Forester, 3 months old, driving up a hill with my parents in California, going to Yosemite to meet up with his folks. We're all going to hang together. And this thing just starts smoking, going up into flames while I'm driving it. I pull over. Strangely enough, there's a cop car behind me.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if he saw the smoke. And he's like, hey, I better go check out what's going on. But, car's burning. And, you know, my parents they're old. They don't know what to do.
Right.
And so struggle to get things out of the car, hurt my shoulder. And I'm like, wait a minute, this car is burning. And my parents, I was like, no, we got to get them out right now. And I grabbed my mom, threw her out of the car, told her to run down the block, you know, same thing with my dad. And then I was like, wait a minute, what am I trying to save here? My computer, my sketchbooks that I spent years on.
Right.
And I was like, ah, fuck it. And I ran away myself. I was like, this is ridiculous. What I'm doing right now as a human, that other side that I always try and repress, the ego side, this is manifesting right here. I need my stuff, my. No, that's not my stuff. I'm something else, you know, than that.
Interesting.
Anyways, but I don't know.
But you guys were, you and your parents were coming out because you had a show in Huntington, and also Martin's got a show out here at
Core
Health.
More the reason about, like, the fact that the bizarre chance that my dad asked me to go on a road trip.
Right.
And I happened to be in the vicinity of Marty to go hang out with my best friend in, you know, fucking L.A.
But, yeah, yeah.
So far, my trip's been going pretty good. Yeah. But I was thinking, I'm like, God damn, like, does my friend have like a hex? Because today I'm at the gallery about to come do this podcast, and I get a text from Sergio from a new phone he had just bought, saying, I think Roland lost his car. I'm like, what? Can you please stay like outside of like a 20 mile radius of me during my opening? Because I don't want a fucking meteor to come through the ceiling.
I think I picked something up during ayahuasca, man. I really do.
I think you're good. I think it's bad shit that at the end of the day, kind of like, I think my reading from the whole thing, at least by what you were saying earlier and what you were just talking about, like, it's all about, we don't have control over things that happen, but we have a control over our reaction to it.
Right.
And I got to say, this dude's reaction and his parents' reaction, because we ended up hanging out with them, like, literally the day after the car burned in Yosemite. Brother. But you guys were all cool about it, man.
Shit,
like,
man.
No one was dwelling on it. We went on, like, hikes and whatever. We went on drives around there. Like, nobody...
Thanks, man.
It was only brought up, really, as kind of a point of hilarity. Like, they would even, like, we were like, hey, anyone got a map of Yosemite? And they hand me a book that's, like, charred. The whole edge was burned off. but it was so funny because I'm like, oh, well, this is still legible. I'm glad you guys saved this, you know? But the cool thing about the whole thing, even with the phone, like, the fact that your iPhone case doubled up as a wallet, meaning that you lost essentially all your shit all at once. It's just, all it goes to show for me, man, is like, it's just stuff. Like, I thought about it where I'm like, dude, let's say you guys had like a pet with you, like a dog in a crate.
Yeah.
And the dog got left in that car. This whole trip would be fucked.
Fucking nightmare.
But you could have lost all your shit. Like, your whole life could have been in there materially. And if you lost it, it's a cool time to like step back and go, no, you didn't lose anything. Yeah. So long as you still have each other and stuff, it's good. So, anyway, I gotta say,
saying that, man.
No, but dude, it's really like so that's what I think is fun is we can just days after the fact, literally a day after you lose your phone or your wallet and shit, you can laugh about it. And it's good. It's good to know that. What is that line? It's like this: the stuff you own ends up owning you. That's not true.
Fight Club. That's exactly.
It can be true for some people who get too attached to those things, but like. At the end of the day, it's just fucking...
Yeah, man, it's a hell of an experience that you had with your family as well.
You know? That's
And true. You guys made it out alive, so, I mean...
Yeah.
I mean, well, like that statement from Fight Club, that it applies directly to, like, everything...
Well, that's where it's from, isn't it? Is that shit really good line?
Dude, Chuck Palahniuk's a genius. Yeah. And, like, honestly, I credit myself with no... originality. I just remember what better people say. like honestly, but that's about not controlling one's mind. Like, yeah, look, you could roll the dice in life. It's chaos though, man.
Right.
Like, you can't let situations dictate your happiness. You're fucked. Like, you could be in, you know, again, a meteor could fall and kill everyone, you know, in the 5 mile radius of you. You can't control that situation.
I would only apply it to stuff. If people around me start getting murdered,
that's a different space thing.
Well, I can't control objects, that either. I can't control if my dad continues to go blind, and you know, not be able to see the fucking Grand Canyon with his son. Like, I can't control it. And what I can control is. What time I have with him now, I push away like an important part of like my life in terms of business. Like, Hi-Fructose article is like first acknowledgement in 10 years of me that my work's cool. Mm-hmm. Now that just doesn't matter to me right now, but like I'm going to give all that work time that I could be like prepping new pieces to sell and shit to hang out with him because it's important, you know?
And also these experiences that enrich your life also are just like will be part of the material that you can actually draw from anyways, and it makes more richer, deeper artwork anyways.
Yeah, I'm interested in making a richer, deeper person,
right?
Because that's going to translate naturally into my work. Like this dude next to me is super fucking deep. Like, profound thoughts run through this guy's head all the time.
Thanks, man.
I guess not fluffing. I'm serious. Like, but. that's, I want to get more of that in my life.
I guess we can actually kind of go there. Like, you guys kind of have an interesting living setup, right? You guys both, I met both of you guys, and what was that, like 4 or 5 months ago?
Yeah, in June. So whatever, October.
The best party ever. Yeah.
Yeah.
It was a pretty good party.
Yeah, and we're up at your guys' spot in Woodstock.
Yeah. Yeah, I would say, like, I want to just clarify that, because whenever I even have that on my Instagram that I'm like Woodstock based, and yeah, it's just that it gives people a general idea of right, where I am.
Yeah, but it's just upstate.
Yeah, it's upstate New York.
No, so it's a like representation Valley, of freedom.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. To be honest, like, Woodstock was a fucking movement of freedom.
Yeah, right? I just wanted, like, just because I've had people from Woodstock, because of my Instagram post, they're like, they live there, and they're like, hey, we should hang out. I'm like, I'm nearby, yeah, right? Like, 20 yeah, minutes yeah, away. Yeah. But anyway, yes.
Undisclosed location, so Brooklyn right, can't follow us up there.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, anyway, it's like it, for anyone listening, it's like Kingston, Woodstock kind of yeah, area. Right. Yeah.
So what's the story there? Like, Martin, you set up shop there first, right? That was like,
I did, yeah.
And you lived in New York City before that, right?
Yeah, I was living in New York for, it was up on 10 years. It was like 9 or 10 years at that point. I first moved from Toronto down to New York to go to school.
Oh, where was that?
At SBA, School of Visual Arts, yeah. So I did my MFA there, and then just decided to stay. Like, the reason to even do my MFA was to get to New York,
right,
to get a student visa and figure it out. And then, so the trajectory was kind of like, I started my career while in New York. I started doing shows and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And then 2012, I ended up having a show at Corey Helfer Gallery. Like, I'm having one there right now, too. And it ended up doing really well.
Sure.
But at the same time, it was interesting. It was like, I'd been playing around with this idea, like, one day, you know, like, I don't want to wait till I, like, quote unquote, retire, but I want to, mm-hmm, I kind of want to get out of New York, but still stay near it.
Right.
Because I love New York, but goddamn, dude, it's a grind.
Yeah.
For everybody there.
It's incredibly like, it's not expensive even, it's abrasive. And
yeah, it's just yeah, like, it has such great aspects to it, but ones that I want to kind of enjoy on my own terms and not be right, trapped by it. And so I started feeling that, like, year 6 or 7 while I was there. Like, up till then, I had been just so high on the idea of being there.
Right.
So
it's got a romantic feeling to it.
Yeah, mm-hmm, yeah. And it really, like, it's just something that I felt like fading off and being replaced by this kind of oppressive feeling, right?
Right.
But meanwhile, also, like, I started, like, dabbling, maybe that's not the right word, but, like, having pretty interesting psychedelic experiences around that time, but in Brooklyn, but, you know. And I had them previously, but there was this kind of like lag when I went to school and all this stuff where I wasn't even really exploring it at all. And I remember it was funny, like, there was this kind of perfect storm where I had the show, as I mentioned, in LA, did really, really well.
Mm-hmm.
And then, so all of a sudden I'm sitting there with just kind of like excess income that I didn't even expect, but it was beyond what I needed to live.
Right.
For even like a year, a couple of years up ahead.
Mm-hmm.
And then I came back home, back to Brooklyn. I remember having like super intense mushroom experience with one of my best friends in my studio. And it was during that trip, like, I was looking around my studio going like, these fucking four walls, like just these like concrete building and these white walls. It was like, I loved the studio. It had a good vibe. But the moment you look out the window of that studio, it's like you're looking at Bushwick, Brooklyn. It's like, right, just like industrial shithole. But so I remember during that trip really going like, what am I even thinking, like investing in Apple stocks or whatever stupid right, shit I was playing around with? Like, literally, I say this to anyone who asks about it. It's like, I attribute the kind of like the impetus to get the place upstate. Because I think it was like a day after that big mushroom trip that I called up a real estate agent, kind of out of the blue,
really?
Just being like, Hudson Valley, I've heard it's cool. I've never even been up there. I've right, driven through it going up to Montreal, but I've never spent time in there. And so really, like, I owe so much of it to what happened during that one night.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not going to say that it happened in some limbo. Like, it happened as a culmination of all these thoughts, yeah, and these kind of
that was just
intuitions I've been having. But it was yeah, really like the kind of the man, turning point that like put me onto the track of being like, hey, you know what? Like, growing up in Finland, I grew up in Finland for the first 12 years of my life. Hmm. My parents had a cottage out in the peninsula there on an island. And I know part of that stayed with me as, like, that's my happy place.
Right.
Like, I can have a happy place among my friends and doing, being active, but there's also this deep desire to be back in nature.
Right.
And that's ultimately what I ended up doing, just going to look for a spot. And then I didn't have a car at the time because I was living in New York. I didn't need one. Just got on a bus, went up there, got picked up by the real estate agent. I think on the fourth time I went up, she had kind of whittled it down to what I was looking for, which was land and some building to use as a studio.
Was it pretty raw at the time? Like your space, was it pretty raw? Like, did you guys do a lot to it?
Oh, man. Like, that's where we're at now. So what happened was, you know, the place that I bought, 6 acres of land, it's nicely situated in that, I mean, you were there, but I'll kind of set it up for people. It's like, it's wooded, but then there's this huge field.
Right.
The field is ringed by trees. So I have neighbors, but you barely ever realize that you even have them.
Sure.
And the place came with a house that was in really bad shape. It was this, like, one-story ranch house that initially when I came up there to look at it, I'm like, if it was just this ranch house, like, forget about it.
Right.
You know, I wouldn't be buying it. But there was it came with a barn, and the barn was somewhat newer, and they were using it as, like, garage/storage. It just had a bunch of shit in there, a couple of crappy garage doors.
Yeah.
But the building itself was fucking awesome. Like, it was, like, super tall ceilings, like a big, big space. But it was completely raw. There's nothing there. There was no insulation, no plumbing in the barn because it was never used for any kind of purpose. But it was such a blank slate for me that I was like, I just fell in love with it, man. I was like, this barn, this land, this is what I was looking for the whole time. And how I lucked out was that the guy who I was buying it from, I guess he had inherited from his dad or stepdad or something. Mm-hmm. Stepdad or dad had passed away and just left it to him, but, like, he didn't give a shit about it, man. Like, he wasn't taking care of it. It was really just like he was willing to go, like, super low on the price because I bet he had a bunch of people come look at it, but they would see the state the house was in and go, like, well, right. What the fuck am I doing with, like, an oversized garage and a shitty house?
Yeah, you know? So it's perfect for you.
Like, oh, it's perfect, man. But see, here's the thing. So, like, I
we still get his mail.
Yeah, we still do. Mark Ogletree, I think.
Ogletree.
So what happened was I converted the barn. It took me a while. It was, like, still about a year and a half of living in Brooklyn and going up there piecemeal, working on it and shit. But eventually, the barn got set up to being kind of like my dream studio scenario.
Yeah, it's really, so great, man.
Thanks, man. Yeah, I'm really, like, I feel like that was my dream project that I got off the ground immediately.
Yeah.
And then, lo and behold, you know, fast forward, like, I think 2 years into owning the place, year and a half or something like that, and Sergio, maybe you want to take over as to where you were at, but, like, Sergio and I had been hanging out quite a lot leading
watching
up to
UFC.
Like, yeah, and it was really over, like, one lunch where it was like, hey, man, it seems like you want to maybe get out of here for a bit. I've got this house. I don't know what to do with it, but you're a handy dude, and I consider myself at least, like, able to learn to be handy, and let's see what we can do.
Right.
And it was supposed to be, like, what, like, a summer's worth of just, like, sleepovers and getting stoned and, like, working on carpentry and shit. But it ended up being, like, what are you, like, a year and a half there now?
Almost 2 years now.
So it was really cool, man, because I feel like, you know.
Well, at that point that he said that, though, made that invitation, I saw a rainbow, like, just arc above his head, and birds came out. I was like, oh, man, this is my way out of New York City.
Yeah, but, like, it worked out well because it's like, the house was that enigma. It was always a question mark. It's like, should I level it? What should I do with it? Because it's maybe it's something I work on for decades and whatever. But meanwhile, one thing about being up there is that it is so beautiful to be so isolated.
Yeah, I was
solace.
I was going to ask about that a little bit. So, like, moving from the city, you can either, like, be confronted with, like, a sense of freedom because it is so vast and open and different, and there's, like, everything. There's, like, a lot of possibilities.
Sure.
Or you could be totally scared and fearful of the whole thing because it's so many possibilities and there's, like, nothing there.
Or it can make you too hard.
And guess what? Yeah. Day in, day out.
Yeah.
It was a beautiful mix of both of those things. It's been that, like, through and through. I think even for both of us, because, like, dude, it's two artists who have no real experience with building a, like, building a house and maintaining a property. And we ran into so many, like, just fundamental issues with how the place was built.
Right, like fixing that, something and then like it raining on your head
right after.
Well, no, for real, like we yeah, we yeah. had.
Like you fix something and you're like on your head and you're like, this is real.
Well, no, we're really like it's leaking again? Like such a weird, strange year of like having your eyes just like pulled open to the reality of what it means to be doing what we are doing, which is to say like. Essentially building something, not from scratch because it has the foundations there, but like trying to figure out, problem solve, how do we do this when we're not exactly off the grid,
right?
But it's not within the network where, you know, you can call on somebody to just like fix something immediately because there's a big sort of concentration of people who do all manner of shit.
So you have to be self-sufficient.
And truth of the matter is like this year, this past year, we had like so many like strangely back-to-back like challenges come our way, including like really, really major ones. And
it was the first year I've ever felt like a man, like an actual man who has got shit and responsibilities and has seen their best friend die. You know,
like, what you want to elaborate on that a little bit, or is that
I kind of started all like literally like the year of shit.
It was really, this was
2014?
No, this year.
2016.
The day
after this guy's birthday.
Okay. So I had a dog called Luna.
Okay.
And she was, I had her for 4 years.
Okay.
I think three or four years, you know. And she was a rescue. She was like half pit, half lab. And somebody who really showed me like what, for a couple of things. First of all, like what absurdity is for there to be like stigma against certain breeds. Like
there's
a big
too.
Thing going on up in Quebec and Montreal where there's this thing called breed specific legislation going on where it's not even a matter of like them banning or taking issue, like legal issue with pit bull specifically.
Right.
But any dog that looks like a pit bull. Like any dog that
wasn't
like
even a fucking pit bull, man.
No, but that's the thing. So but
even
so,
if it was
so,
it totally was, it's still
but it's
ridiculous.
Just fucking
like
insane.
Stop and frisk. So hey, just, that one's bad.
Yeah.
Let's
yeah.
fucking kill it. Yeah. That's the legislation. Like that is actually it.
Yeah, yeah.
Like,
so
they're euthanizing pit bulls.
Mm. Yeah. Well, so the reason for bringing that up is that what Luna taught me, because up till then, like I'd had a dog once far back, but in Luna's case, it was, you know, I just took her in as a rescue and she had some history. Nobody really knows what was going on. Like when I got her, she was, she had been used at a vet, veterinary, I guess like a school for vets as shaving practice for surgeries.
Oh.
Right. So when I got her, she had this big patch shaved on her side where they were like showing incoming vets how to perform surgery on that specific area or whatever. Right. So it was really like, it was weird, but I don't think that it caused a whole lot of trauma. And I actually figured out that the vets to be were probably super kind to her.
Right.
Like I noticed she had this pattern with certain people, just even by appearance, that there was some major trauma with regards to certain, like the look of certain people.
Right.
And then she was very, very trusting of others. But so anyway, so I had to like deal with that from the get-go, but in the course of which I realized like, no, if you spend enough time like really developing a relationship with an animal like this, like they become not even like a friend, a friend isn't the right word, like they become like a sister to you.
Yeah, your family member, sister, for sure. They're, you know? They depend on you for their lives.
In every way, man. Right. And in a way you become, I wouldn't say like dependent on them, but the bond becomes so...
Well, they show you love.
Yeah,
they show you unbridled love, like love that you could never get from a human.
Right.
Like a very strange, like it's life-changing.
Mm-hmm.
Like to own a pit bull is absolutely life-changing. Mm-hmm. And
they'll give
their life for you. And that's what Luna thought she was doing with us.
Mm-hmm.
Like I watched her for quite a bit before I moved upstate into
Marty's cabin. And dude, like, I mean, I felt like it was best friend 1.5 years of knowing her, let alone two.
So yeah. Luna passed away? Is that
what you're saying? So it was my birthday, middle of January. My birthday is January 13th. And January 14th, it's just odd. I'm not putting anything on this other than it's been a very strange year of, like, almost like perfectly timed
tragedy
storms, you know, right, to deal with, right? So for, you know, whatever, like Luna never had a tendency to go off the property. Okay. It just so happened that day on January 14th, it was, you know, just snowy outside. It was like a full-on winter day. And she'd tend to bark at the post office dude. Like, not him, but his truck. He would drive up the driveway.
Mm-hmm.
But he was just doing his daily delivery. Mm-hmm. I was like, all of a sudden, I'm like, where the fuck's Luna? Luna had run after, like, gone the way up to the road.
Yeah.
And ran under the truck.
Well, she tried to attack the tires. Like,
right. Yeah,
like,
and then
when you
rolled under.
When you drive your tractor around the field to, like, mow the lawn.
Yeah.
She would always try and attack the tires.
Yeah, she was like,
Because she was, you know, trying to. She thought you were in peril or danger.
No, it was funny. Like, it was such a funny habit she would have. Is like, I would sometimes, like, I'd have, like, ride with, like, a girl on my tractor.
Hell yeah.
And I remember I had one girl, she was down from Montreal. I remember she was, like, riding behind me, like, you know, like, motorcycle style. And Luna went and bit her on the ass.
Yeah.
Because she was trying to, like, save her from this weird, like, orange.
Yeah, like.
Orange buffalo that was, like, carrying her away.
And audience, you know? I've seen that ass. And my God, it's so worth biting. So Luna did right. Well.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. Well,
saying that, Marty did well. Because I'm sure he did that as many.
But back to the topic at hand. So anyway, so that's like a long preamble to say that, like, the year started with, like, a huge tragedy. Like, yeah, I've never experienced anything like that. Like, I've had to give up, like, you know, let my grandmother go, who I was very close with. I had to let my dad go, who I was close with. And then I let Luna go. And I'll tell you, man, it's not that my love for the other people I mentioned was any less, but this was a bond that I didn't realize was that. Like, right. I knew it was deep, but I had no idea how devastating it would be.
It's kind of like a child, too, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, it was very much like I could very much then, as of then, I can fully empathize with any loss that is of that magnitude,
right?
You know, so anyway, so for what it's worth, it was like the year started with that and it fucked me up hard. Like, I was really, really fucked up from it for a while. And like, it's just that then, while it was still full on winter, like I think a month later, all of a sudden, like the property started showing its failings, not the property as it stands, but how it was built on that property. So we're on like a big slate side of a mountain, essentially. So we're on slate rock.
Right.
And when it rains super heavily, we learned the hard way that the water doesn't seep through the slate. It just, if it rains tons and tons at a certain volume for a while, it rises up and then starts flooding everything. Mm-hmm. So like, oh, right, this place has no fucking drainage.
Wow.
Like nothing. Right. So like middle of the winter, the ashes of our best friend are still like smoldering technically and like, or proverbially speaking. And here we are like renting an excavator, have no idea what we're doing, like digging a ditch through the property, trying to figure out like where does the water want to go if it ever happens again. Because I had that happen again, man, like the basement of the house would flood again. It threatened to breach the barn. It came right up to the barn door, and we're like, okay, so now we're dealing with this. And then, what was it, a month after that, the house roof started leaking. Like, Sergio was living in there, and all of a sudden, it's like, I remember you coming in, and you're like, I don't know if I should mention this, because all this other shit had been going on. I was super stressed, and I'm supposed to be getting this show ready and whatever, and like, you came in and you're like, I don't know if I should mention this, but the roof has started to leak. And we had put up all this insulation. We were getting the roof ready. So
I spent hours and hours doing it too.
But all this said, so this is not my way of like complaining about it. It's all, this is all the necessary steps, not the Luna thing, that's, though there's certain teachings in there that I think I'm grateful to have received.
Yeah.
Like, it's a horrifying thing to happen, but I think I'm, on some level, I've like replaced grief with like gratitude now for the whole thing.
Well,
but
the tragedy grows flowers.
It can, like, that's the thing. It can in that, but you have to acknowledge what it is that you can learn from it. Cause I could very well see myself still be entirely just grief struck by it.
Yeah.
But it has over time been replaced, but it's kind of a strange appreciation. It's like I said, like I feel like I can empathize on a greater level now with somebody else going through something like that. Cause now right. It's like for the first time in my life, like, holy shit. Like, I get it now. And when if I see like even a headline of somebody losing their child to some kind of like tragedy of drowning or whatever, I'm like, dude, I know.
You feel more now.
Yeah.
Like, that's like, just to explain what I just said, like, tragedy grows flowers. I was, as he was talking about this, I was looking up at that Navajo blanket or just native blanket. I don't know if it's Navajo or not, but it's an eye turned on its side with tears coming down, but the bottom of that looks like two petals for a flower. So, you know,
that's cool.
Out of tragedy, you learn, you grow, you like, and what Martin's saying is absolutely true. Like, I feel 100% more after this tragedy.
Right.
Like, I have more compassion, more of a man, of more of a measured individual.
Right.
You know, like, the simple things in life that I used to consider so important,
right,
like getting fucked up with my friends in New York City, you know, going out and raising your numbers and notches on your belt and all that crazy bullshit that you've sort of get pulled into this tornado of ego in that city. Like, dude, God, man, I have not a bone in my body that wants to be part of any of that shit. Like, and I see that as, I hate to say it, I see it as stalled. I see that as locked in. Right. And man, I feel so much more. I feel like so much more of a human. I was so lost there. You know, I think everyone kind of experiences that in New York.
Yeah. To some degree. This is an interesting thing, actually. You probably don't remember this, but I met you, I think, at Pulse Art Fair 2014.
Whoa.
With was you and Michael for the booth.
Co-directing that gal.
Yeah, and I remember meeting you, and I swear to get the like I was telling Martin before you got here, that I was like, I can't believe that was the same guy. Because I was telling him, it's like when I met you, I met you and Michael at the same time. And Michael's a guy, he's like a previous director, for the listeners, previous director at Arcadia, or co-director, or whatever.
Yeah.
And good friends with him as well. But when I met you, I was like, the thing I came in with was, I was like, damn, that guy's really intense, you know?
Yes.
I know, Sergio, you were in sales mode or whatever it was, but you're just,
Sergio,
I just remember
a different guy.
Meeting you guys and you're just like, just really, I don't know, like a New York dude. That's how I felt about it. And I was like, wow, that's gnarly.
But we're in Greenwich Village, raised in New Jersey. So you have like the skunky attitude of a New Jersey dude.
Yeah.
Versus like, someone who's more attuned to the arts and born in Greenwich Village, in St. Vincent's. But like, dude, I was a different guy.
So what happened? I guess like that's why I wanted to interview you guys at the same time, because I want to understand the narrative and story about how you guys ended up where you are, you know, and how your paths crossed. So
I used to, I mean, all right, so that's a tough one because you might have to have me on a second time to tell you the whole story.
Well, just start wherever, you know.
Too
just
much. Okay. So starting from years at Arcadia, not what led me to Arcadia.
Yeah. Oh, also for the listeners, Arcadia is a gallery in New York, predominantly representational, or they were in New York.
Yeah, they're in LA now.
Yeah. They moved, and the building burned
in Soho.
Yeah. What?
Really,
dude? He moved out before it burned.
Dude, I must
the
have
whole
moved
building
too.
Burned.
The top of it burned, and because of the structural damage, they had to tear down the building.
Really?
Whoa.
Well, my studio is right down the block from there. I didn't know that. Like, that's where I moved from.
It was something
that's
like
crazy.
Green Street.
Yeah, Green. Yeah, 60, yeah. I was at 68 Green, and you guys were whatever.
Yeah. Well, shit.
Well, briefly, what led me to Arcadia and how many jobs have I been there doing before I got to be a co-director there for the Uptown Gallery? Well, in short, starting with when I first met Marty, was that we had one of his pieces in a group show.
I think I've only done one
group. You had the polar bear piece inside in the show. It was like right as you were moving out of what's his name's gallery that Ryan Bradley's at.
Lions Weir,
yeah. It was we picked up the piece from Lions Weir and like
no, yeah.
It was a group show.
No, anyway. Yeah, I was in that group show. No, it was Billy was in it too, wasn't he?
Yeah, and so was Adam.
Yeah, no, I sold my piece in that show. Me and Billy both did.
Oh shit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyways. Back to your story.
We have a mutual really good friend named Brad.
Brad Kunkel, right?
And Brad was like, yo, this guy Sergio's awesome. You get along with him. And you invited me out to, like, have, like, I don't know, food over your place when you had a bunch of people over. And then I just started knowing you. Yeah.
Yeah.
What is there anything else?
UFC,
yeah.
Man.
UFC.
I don't know.
Yeah, but
I think at some point we realized we're.
How did I
both
find out
like,
that you liked UFC?
I have no idea, dude. I think that this is so going back to what you said before, like you know, whatever, like. Getting drunk and doing shit in New York, like I don't want to see it all as a waste of time because like you brought yeah. people like you and me.
Yeah,
together.
No, totally. Right. I'm over that. I don't know. I'm over.
Yeah, it's just that previous chapter. But I guess like chapter, yeah. The thing that I was interested is you said you were a different guy. How did you like in the last like this was only a few years ago when I first met you briefly. You know.
Yeah.
So like, what happened that like he had his impetus with like. His psychedelic experience finally pushing him over the edge into like this major change. What did it for you? And it, not just you guys meeting, but ending up living in this like alternative space.
So we're watching every UFC together.
Yeah.
And I'm like, shit, man, this guy's fucking work is awesome. He's hilarious as fuck. And he's, he's calling these UFCs on the point.
Dude, you know what I heard you just say?
What?
He's hilarious to fuck.
not what I said. That's not why I live upstate.
Just to clarify.
Yeah, yeah. No, he's hilarious as fuck.
Okay.
Yeah. No, Misha Tate, I want to fuck.
Good. Good
sorry,
clarify.
Cupcake, yeah. But I had to say that you are tremendously hot. A women's division champ that got dethroned
sure,
recently. Dude. The conversation just goes there.
Dude, you took it there.
Yeah. And I think what happened to me was that I was just going through like a dissolving of my brain. Like,
what do you mean? Just the stress and abrasion of the city or like the
lifestyle?
Well,
yeah, it was like basically quitting this job as a director for Arcadia's North Gallery on 57th Street, which also happened to be housed in the Ty Warner Four Seasons building, which is the most expensive hotel in all of New York City.
Okay.
And like it was $50,000 a night.
What? Whoa.
Yeah. So you're getting Saudi oil, you're getting royalty, you're getting sheiks, and I had to like memorize all this shit because they saw me directing that gallery and they're like, hey, pretty good at selling, you're pretty fucking personable, and every rich person here seems to like you.
Yeah.
They all talk about you. Why don't you apply for the job as concierge? And I was like, concierge? They're like, no, concierge. I'm like, let me think about it. And then I took the job.
As the concierge?
Yeah.
So you quit Arcadia?
Quit Arcadia, and they slapped a $3,000 suit on my ass and, you know, like told me to shave my beard and join in with the crew and learn the ways of the... I knew the ways of the wealthy
because
I used to sell to them. Now I'll get to know the ways of the extremely wealthy.
Right.
You know, make reservations for Nancy Sinatra and, you know, talk to Samuel L. Jackson without losing your shit, man.
Right. But where's the art and all this stuff? Like, what happened
Art's
to that?
Gone.
Art's gone?
Art's gone.
Was that really a... That must have been eating at you.
Well, it's like the... Dude, I hate to be saccharine, but it's like the Bhagavad Gita. Like, my calling, my Arjunan calling is to make work. And when you lie to yourself for 10 years after you get no appreciation for the work that you make in 2006. I mean, these fucking heads in 2006, man.
Yeah, and you do, like, just so the listeners, like, knows, I mean, if they're not familiar already, but you do these massive or large-scale drawings on canvas, right?
Yeah, pencil
for the
drawings.
Most part, for the most part, like, graphite, yeah.
250 to 500 hours to complete. At least back in the day they did when right. I had time. I did that in 2006, had a solo show. No, I mean, again, this is a long, long ass story. So sure. It's another podcast or whatever.
Yeah.
But, to jump to the chase, you give up that part of yourself, which is your ultimate truth.
Mm-hmm.
And then the maladies start coming because it's like a festering lie inside of you.
Man. You're repressing something.
You're repressing something. And then you're being told by your associates and to be something else.
Right.
And that's fine. That's the world that they live in. But it's not a world that I live in. And if I'm going to work 40 to 60 hours a week and not be myself for most of that time, then who are you?
Mm-hmm.
You're no one. You're some made up thing. And I can't really, you know, I grew up watching Conan the Barbarian, like studying it, and Rocky IV and montages and courage. And just, it took time to see the courage in another friend who took a fucking chance out of a belief system where he's like, hey, this feels encroaching. This city's horrible. Moves himself up there, needs help building a dream.
Right.
I want to build my dream too.
Hey. So that was the inspiration, as like that opportunity.
Seeing
to move out
him
there.
And how he's living his life was the inspiration, and he's really the first one. People come out to the party, and you know that it's great. I'm glad that they feel freedom and shit like that. But none of that shit would be possible without Marty.
True.
You know, seriously, that's what, like, my birthday was in September 10th. That's what I said. Like, they're like, toast. They sprayed me with champagne and shit like that.
Right.
I was like, great. None of you assholes would be out here without this guy. So, not, you know,
quite like that.
I was much more jovial. But, like, sure. You know, artists are flaky and shit. You know, you have some people who come out to parties are just like trying to get ahead and shit.
Right.
I got no agenda.
Yeah, yeah.
I got nothing that I'm trying to complete here.
Right.
I'm giving you me,
you
know, and I just wish more people would get that mindset in their heads and that the artist is the fucking underdog in this crazy messed up society that we invented. And we got to band together. So get over your shitty little disputes, artists, and like join together, man. Like,
but that said, I have to say what's cool to kind of observe is just picking where I would land with the place that we set up.
Right.
It's actually starting to become kind of a hub, like not due to us being there. Like, it's not that that's what's happening. Like, but there, it seems like there's quite a lot of people moving up now, especially artists and people who are seeking out their kind of like creative freedom.
Yeah, I think that people are escaping the city.
But there's still, like, what's cool is that, you know, of course, a lot of people are being pulled to places like Asheville, North Carolina, maybe Portland, like
or even here in LA.
Whereas, like, it's cool to see that right down the road from us, I mean, it's like 10, 15 minute drive, you got Kingston, which is, you know, Brad just moved up there.
He moved
up there in June.
Another warrior. Seriously.
And I feel like more and more of that is going to happen, not just among our circle of friends, though it is something to observe that because people have been coming up generally in the summer, people come up quite a lot to where we're at.
Yeah.
And it does kind of, I do think it serves an example in the sense of like, hey, up here, I mean, the overhead's not high at all.
Sure.
It really is, like, it could even be down the line, like just like a retreat if I wanted to have some other spot or whatever, but like, but it is, I feel like it's something that I think is resonating with people, is that just 2 hours away from this one like central hub,
right?
It's not prohibitively far. Like, you really can do a day trip. I wouldn't want to do that commute every day, but it's not crazy bad at all. And just because of that now becoming sort of like, I want to say like a contagious kind of a feeling among people.
It's a logical move too.
It serves as a beacon.
Yeah.
Like, it serves as a beacon. That's the thing, is that it's a beacon of freedom and, you know, understanding that we can band
together here.
And, but I would even say that like it's cool to observe that while we're building away at our spot, the more we're getting to know our neighborhood, we realize, oh, there's other people did this completely like unrelated to us. Like they're just there. They either came before or they're coming up now. Because even just now, I was just walking around with Brad the other day, just before I took my flight out to San Fran to be on this trip. We're just walking around. We were walking with his dog right around like where the bus stop is. And it's like, oh shit, look at that new clothing store. Like it's like that store would be a total transplant from Williamsburg, let's say.
And now like, they do like Smorgasburg.
Yeah, but the franchises haven't arrived yet. Like,
whoa.
Like it's yes, there's a part of Kingston, of course, is like all the big box stores and shit like that. But I feel like that old part, it's not. There's no tumbleweeds.
Yeah, it's not gone yet. But also, like the fact of the matter that it's kind of like been a place of freedom. That whole area, man. Like, there's a van across the street from across the road from where we live. That's like you could tell it was like a converted hippie van, man. There's like a smokestack to it and a chimney and shit.
Wow. But that's like, the thing. I think that initially that was my sort of tongue in cheek, like compass. Direction was pointing up at Woodstock. It was like, okay, I just had a big mushroom trip telling me to get the fuck out of Dodge and like move to the woods. And I was like, well, Woodstock sounds good. But it really, like, the more time we spend there too, like, you realize, like, there is something about that area that I think does speak to people of that mindset.
Sure.
Like people who still want to have a finger somewhat on the pulse of what's going on sort of culturally and be able to interact with it.
Yeah.
Well, but attracting like-minded too.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, like, you know, just because Woodstock itself, I mean, it's gotten, I guess, pretty campy over time because there's quite a lot of like head shops and like tie-dye shops.
Sure. Yeah.
But that's all fun. Like it's all part of the fun and they have drum circles. Sunday. But dude, it has something special there because it's such a small place and very clearly there are these spots where it's like, oh, this band that recorded shit in their 60s, they recorded right there. And
like, yeah, there's like kind of like a counterculture history.
Yeah, yeah, and it's never gone anywhere. And I feel like it's still so far removed from New York where like New York City has this one disturbing kind of trend happening where it's like as soon as a place, any neighborhood gets popular,
yeah,
these fucking glass condos go up, and I get it. I get it. I get why that would be, but I feel like maybe the flavor of history is eventually going to get completely erased.
Yeah,
because the moment you see like an old, beautiful, like you know, like old fire engine house being taken down, a Chase Bank goes up. Like I feel like something very like fundamentally disturbing has just happened to that area, you know?
Right.
And with regards to a place like Kingston or Woodstock, I don't feel like it's ever at a threat of that happening.
Sure.
I don't want to like eat my words in 20 years, but.
Well, you shouldn't have said the name of the place. Now everyone's going to come.
I meant Kingston, Jamaica.
Kings County, Brooklyn.
Yeah, I mean, we've got a listenership of like 3 or 4 million, so I think,
or it's probably fine.
Yeah.
just kidding. Man, I don't want to shift focuses, too abruptly, but I did want to get into, since you came out here for your show and everything, I would like to talk about the work a little bit.
Sure.
And kind of where that comes from, because you're like, your work is uniquely like representational, but of almost like, as far as I've seen, almost like purely animal based.
Yeah.
Where does that come from? Why? And like, what are you trying to like explore with that as like, as the basis for your work?
All right. So there's so many, like what seems to be almost an infinite array of, representational work that use human figures as the kind of agents to express whatever the idea might be. In the piece, like, let's say it's allegory or whatever it is,
right.
it's something I've seen so many times, and there was just something about shifting the focus from having a human representation of that,
right,
to something that I feel is maybe more ancestral, in the sense that if we look very far back at, let's say, old cave paintings, well, what did they paint? They painted often you know, they would paint human figures in there, but very often they would turn to the animal figure.
Right.
They were, these were beings that they had a certain kinship with, whether it was them providing them food or on a very spiritual basis, you know, they represented some kind of inner form of the human condition. Right. Mm-hmm. So using that as kind of like my springboard, like the basis for why I would turn to the same kind of subject matter is that I think that the animal forms, especially in my paintings and how I convey them, these aren't paintings about animals. Technically, what I think I'm going for is the animals in my paintings are sort of symbolic stand-ins for something we're collectively going through, or at the very least, something I'm distilling through my sort of subjective lens about the world that I live in and the times I'm living in. So a lot of my work has to do with, you know, I'm placing the animals inside of landscapes that are somehow man-made or affected by our, what we, I guess we could call our like ambition or our progress. Often it's sort of like industrial debris or like abandoned stuff that these animals are interacting with. But there's always something in the work that in the animals themselves or in the environments, how they're interacting with the animals, that point back to some kind of human story.
Right. And I feel like the allure of a lot of like figurative work with human figurative work is that like you can immediately relate to that person in there. Like you can't help it, but you see another, like people do it all the time, like the pareidolia thing. You see a face everywhere, you project onto that thing.
Sure.
And I think with animals, there's almost like this instinct to feel them as more of an innocent, not a bystander, but like something that is more innocent than a human being. You know, almost more of a blank slate.
No, totally.
You
know, but see, here's what's fun is that, so this latest show, it's just a continuation of like an ongoing kind of theme that I have been playing with for quite a while, but it's like just zeroing in more on that very specific kind of concept, which is, so I picked up from Terence McKenna, who's a psychedelic philosopher who's no longer around, but he had this concept and he wrote a book about it called The Archaic Revival. And in The Archaic Revival, he's arguing, so kind of like the overview of The Archaic Revival, and his view was that modern society, contemporary society and culture has gotten sick over quite a while, especially once we hit the industrial age and we synced up with this kind of industrial machinery.
Right.
And we got very trapped inside our own pursuits of matter. Right. And what he's arguing for is that to heal ourselves, even on a subconscious level, if you look at the 20th century as being a good example of this, with Freud and Jung starting to look at the subconscious, with primitivism showing up in art, such as Picasso turning to like African masks. Then you look at music that started coming up, which is syncopated music, which is shamanistic drumming music came through. All of this stuff came just at the same time as the war machine was taking over. So what he's arguing for is that we, on many levels, turn to the archaic, the ancient methods and behaviors and the values for a reconnection to what we actually are, which is a human animal.
Right.
So underneath the veneer of civilization, underneath the trappings of our language, and the fact that language is often what gets us in trouble with one another because we simply can't understand one another on such a basic level. So his argument was that if we can find our way back to more ancient methods of communicating with each other, we also have to find ways by which we can communicate within ourselves, like with ourselves. How do we unravel that and crack it open? So he was a big advocate for psychedelic plant medicines to do that. So that's where my kind of connection to Terence began from that, because I have a similar fascination with the same topic, but I'm now extrapolating more to my work and to say that, hey, we really, like, if Terence was still alive today, he'd be pushing his idea even more, I would say, because if there's ever been a time that we kind of collectively need to start coming up with solutions by which we recognize again the primal self that we actually really are at our core, that's the only way that we're going to start healing a world that it's too thinky, it's too cerebral, it's too us, or them. Yeah. It's too divided, it's too ideological. It's in a lot of ways we keep running into the same problems as we have for quite a while as a species, but now we're all interlinked in such a way that it's like, it, you know, I think nature is starting to really show us in her own way that enough.
Right.
Like it's maybe time that we had like a really, really solid inward look at ourselves on an individual level, but then collectively as we actually at the very basic level, we're much more primitive than we take ourselves to be.
Right. I guess sorry. I don't mean to cut you off there.
No. Just to close on that. I just feel like in that sense, I feel that again, like returning to why I would choose animal figures to kind of represent that idea in my work. It's kind of to point to the idea that, you know, you mentioned the idea that animals to us represent sort of innocence.
Yeah. Or an otherness like that, you know, like it's like a stand-in symbol for like, like you're saying, like what we used to be connected to or whatever before technology, like we were evolving like in like co-evolution with what we consider technology. Now.
Right.
So
right.
We react to that versus more than like the more natural landscape of things. Like we created this thing and now evolve in conjunction with this other thing.
Exactly. Right.
And so that it's like, that's almost the more dominant life form at a certain point. Cause it evolves.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, so Rick Doblin, who's the founder of MAPS, it's a multidisciplinary association of psychedelic studies. He's going to be a historical figure. I mean, he's doing so much to further kind of like Terence McKenna's idea, but really taking it into the field in the sense of like he's figuring out ways by which he can even present to the Pentagon how he could help vets get over PTSD, which is a huge fucking problem. That
it's like psilocybin or something.
Well, it's MDMA assisted psychotherapy, something he's been pushing, but MAPS also funds the psilocybin therapy studies, which do the same kind of thing. You know, like there's so many different ways by which MAPS is now reaching out into the world and really like taking a therapeutic kind of a curing angle onto things that previously were deemed to be uncurable. Right.
Right.
So the reason I bring up Rick Doblin, he had this great quote that I love. He said, "We as a species were technologically extremely advanced, but emotionally very primitive."
Hmm.
We haven't married those two things together because I'm not one to say that the archaic revival ought to represent a halting of technological progress. In fact, I say the opposite. I think technology could be this incredible tool by which we start harnessing, let's say, the power of the sun to help us with things. So as to stop demanding extreme pressures from the earth. You know what I mean? Like, or to demand a consistent flow of resources that will run out. Like, these are all problems that we're really, really facing in a major way now. But at the same time, clever minds that I think are tuned from clever to maybe wise. I think wisdom is a different thing from being simply intelligent. I think that wisdom is where emotion and thought come together, you know? And I would say that if we all open ourselves up emotionally, let's say, for example, with the aid of psychedelics,
right?
Because that's what they do, is they show you the core sort of emotional landscape that is within all of us. And that often severs for people who are too sort of trapped within logic. It severs them from that kind of loop and opens them up to this wider thing. Well, I would just say that for us to move forward with wisdom, it could very well be employing great technology as an ally to heal our relationship with the world.
Right, yeah.
Rather than destroy it, because thus far the status quo, when in the hands of the military and the politicians in the way that they have been operating, all this cleverness is leading us to fucking disaster, man.
Right.
But it doesn't have to be that way.
Right.
So hence the archaic revival, for what it's worth, it's like, it could mean a whole lot of things, and it should mean a whole lot of things, but I guess what it means in my mind is a certain kind of global awakening.
Right.
And I hope that just being able to contribute to that dialogue, it just makes that candle burn just a little bit brighter.
You know? Right. So, and I guess like the wisdom to me was always like the more empathetic branch of intelligence, right?
Yeah.
And I guess like
exactly.
When you have the work that you have where you like you take this an animal which is often seen as this innocent object. Like in a movie when millions of people could get murdered by a serial killer, but when the dog dies, feels worse. That hurts more. Yeah. So there's that thing that you can't help but feel that empathy for that creature. Sure. And then when you in the work that you have, where they're like either on fire or some like weird kind of human made elements causing this animal distress, there's like a kind of a gut feeling of. I don't know. Like, there's a tension that's building there because of that symbol of innocence being kind of violently, aggressively stomped on by like whatever is happening in the human element of the piece.
Yeah, yeah, no, totally. Like innocence being violated.
Right. Yeah, that's a better, more direct way of putting it.
Well, yeah, and I think that's that observation spot on. It's because I feel like just even. Like this kind of subcutaneous guilt that I feel living in the time that I do live in and in many ways contributing to it.
Yeah.
With that, like there are ways that I can mitigate that, but not entirely get rid of my footprint.
Right.
I'm not walking right on the edge of the ocean as it comes in and washes my footprint away. It's like I'm far up the beach still. Right. So when I look back at my life, I think like, oh man, like I have so much to ask forgiveness for in a way. But I feel like we all do, but the more we can start having that kind of hindsight to kind of look back and say like, hey, you know, I am going to try and walk more lightly moving forward in that way. That is something that I certainly aspire to. And I hope that more people do as well. But I think that,
I think you're definitely doing it, brother.
Oh, thanks, man. Well, I would just say though that the impetus for making that kind of imagery, where I do turn to this ravaging of these natural beings, that these sort of like deities, even sometimes I paint some of the animals as if though they were these kind of sacred entities.
Sure.
But there's something quite often compromising their well-being, as you pointed out. And that's that a lot of that stems from that kind of feeling that I have, which is there. It's almost as if though I'm painting self-portraits in a way.
Right.
In a strange kind of way.
I mean, I guess most of the paintings are for most people in some way, right?
Yeah.
But like what I'm getting from what you're saying, I don't mean to cut you off too much. Building some kind of empathy, right? Like you seeing this thing that like is detached from the human form, but you still feel that connection to in some capacity, whether you're like projecting all these things onto it. It's like a way of like, building some kind of empathy towards what's happening. How the ripple effects of your existence on everything else.
Exactly. Yeah. I wonder how it would go about this whole thing if I didn't have some kind of outlet like that in which to express it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I feel like I dwell in my head quite a lot anyway, but I think that being able to process or distill that stuff into work, into artwork, helps me not go too insane with it.
Yeah.
I'm actually generally a very happy person, so I think some of it has to do with the fact that I feel like I have some outlet by which to at least try and communicate about the turmoil that I think I feel, as do a lot of other people. So you know in a way it's just, I hope, especially with the internet being this extremely powerful tool, I feel like now for communicating in myriad ways, you know, whether it's music or podcasts or whatever, like there's so many ways by which people are now getting their kind of inner world out there, however they want to express it.
Yeah.
I'm just hoping that this time kind of yields a lot of fertility for people to see their own potential mm-hmm. in contributing to something that we were just talking about, which is collectively trying to come up with some kind of way by which we could heal a very long kind of long-standing wound that keeps being reopened by a lot of shit that still happens in this world, you know? Well, that's going to keep happening.
Salt being poured in the wound.
Yeah.
North Dakota pipeline. Mm. Disrespecting native cultures. You know,
all cultures. Donald that's
Trump.
Really...
Donald fucking Trump.
But that pipeline's really dangerous to all, like, everybody, right?
Yeah, yeah,
totally
yeah.
Totally poison, like...
Yeah.
Millions of people's well, water sources.
He's the greatest representation of a fire demon I ever saw.
Oh, I mean, Trump too, yeah. Yeah. So yeah. I was talking about the pipeline, but yeah.
Well, the pipeline, yeah. I mean, that's who he's...
Yeah.
Yeah, if that guy gets through, that's what happens.
Right.
That's America goes back to its devilish ways of manifest destiny across the world this time. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't know. Maybe not. Maybe he's a great businessman.
No, let's not do
that. Maybe. Hey.
Don't even give him an yeah. inch, bro.
Nah, exactly. Yeah. Well, I mean, a good example of it is like, dude, we were just in Yosemite. Our parents are super friends now. Just because whatever, they've hung out before. And they're like, hey, we're going to be in Yosemite. Like, hey, we're going to be in Yosemite. And here we are walking through a beautiful, ancient place. And, you know, bride's veil falls. Literally, the bride's veil fell. Mm. It's dry. Like, my parents were there 5 years ago, and now it's got a trickle of water.
Yeah.
This is real.
Like, things are changing. I don't know if
things
it's
are
like
changing,
some,
man.
Some naturally cyclical drought, but there's something about it just being there that it felt almost apocalyptic.
I thought I was going to enjoy it as a nature experience, man.
Well, but it was really like I was still mesmerized by it. I was like, this place, like, if we cease to be around, I feel like this place is still going to be this incredibly beautiful thing for all intents and purposes, what will seem like an infinite amount of time, and that gave me some hope. But there was something about being there and having just driven, like, the way to get there from San Francisco is you have to drive through the desert.
Yeah.
I don't know what part of the desert that would be called, but it's like coming into the Sierras, and then all of a sudden you're in Yosemite.
Right.
And on the way there, too, it's like, yes, I realize I'm in the desert, but it was so fucking dry. Like, there was not a shred of, like, really green anywhere, and then... And then, but so here's what the kind of tell was, like, we're driving through and we pass a couple of these big signs they have, like, right on the road, these big ass signs in front of what looked like a field out of, like, Mad Max. Like, this, you can't possibly grow anything in that shit, but big signs saying ranchers for Trump, right? Then little ways down the road, there's like, of course, there's like a big cross and there's a chapel and then you keep going, it's another one, it's like farmers for Trump. I'm like, Jesus Christ, where are we? Then we get to Yosemite and I'm like, okay, good, we're in Yosemite. This seems like a sane place, because the human story now has been replaced by the majesty of this, like,
right,
infinitely ageless natural story, right? But I feel like that natural story had been severely impacted somehow by the ignorance of this stupid high thinking or big brain primate. Right. Because once we got there, I don't know. Like, I actually want to read up on it and see what's up, but Yosemite had like so many huge pine trees. Some of them may have even been redwoods or whatever, these massive trees, and so many of them were dead.
Well,
just dying,
they're
dude.
Trump supporters.
Something that was pretty something that's pretty strange to me is, like, I just went up last month to Seattle, where my parents are at, and they're in a drought for the first time in who knows how long. I mean, you know,
yeah, that's strange.
That's really crazy. Yeah. Like, I went there, my parents' lawn is completely dead. It's brown. Wow. There's like water shortages.
That's
out there,
so strange.
Man. It's pretty intense.
Things are changing. Yeah, I've been quickly. Seattle
something's
once.
Happening. Yeah, like, I don't, quickly, I can't figure out exactly. I mean, there's, it's a pretty sophisticated and complex set of reasons that this is going on. But
well, if you had cancer, you'd use chemo, correct? Try and blast it with radiation from the sun to kill it?
Maybe.
I think maybe, perhaps, the Earth is the same way.
Yeah.
It knows that it's got some kind of infection on it.
Right.
And, you know,
Look, or, hey, it's like running maybe, a fever.
Perhaps.
Like, yeah.
Perhaps.
It's or maybe. Fever, I mean, yeah. I don't know. I'm no weather scientist here, but what if our overconsumption of water and the water not ending up where it normally would
right.
leads to not being able to evaporate in the same way it normally would so as to dump water where yeah. it should go?
I don't know shit because so that, that's we have like, overpopulation.
Right.
Well, that's exactly yeah. it. Like, I feel like it's all those factors combined. It's all like it's a big sort of witch's brew that we're
yeah. It's multifaceted. Together, you
know? Yeah, it's so it's but again, like who knows? Like maybe I don't know this, but maybe it is just some natural phenomena that cyclically happens. But I just have to say that my first time going to Yosemite, but especially being there with a couple, in this case your parents, who had been there the same time of year just a few years ago. And they were both like, this is so weird. Last time we were here, it was like really green. Like mm-hmm. The meadows were green, whereas now it's like, it looked like wheat fields. It's all just yellow.
Mm-hmm.
And as we said, like the falls had dried up. There are only two falls open out of however many
mm-hmm.
when we went. And the fall that we saw was like, dude, it was like a dude was standing up there just pissing from the top of the mountain. Like where normally it's supposed to be, like wow. just raging.
Wow. Right? Very ugly man.
No, beautiful man with like very clear white pee, you know.
Yeah. No, but like it's
yeah, white pee. I don't think that's pee, man. Yeah.
A very happy man.
Man, everyone wants to be that man.
But anyway, like that's not whatever. Like that's kind of like a bummer way yeah. of saying. Something that ultimately, though, like,
well, no, let's speak reality. It, you know, that's the reality.
Sure.
Of it. Look, it's the reality of it. Whatever it is causing it, mm-hmm. whether the Earth's going through a cycle or whether, you know, the sea level's rising, you have island nations who are pleading with the UN to, you know, help them. It's going to start happening here. Maybe. Yeah. This is all maybes. Maybe it's both. Maybe it's the planet's going through change. Maybe it's literally due to the overpopulation of the planet and the non-replenishment of that shit. It's happening. Whatever it is, it's happening. And yeah. once those polar ice caps go and it reveals the methane pockets underneath, you're going to have an escalation in the Earth's atmosphere,
right.
which is going to drive global warming even faster. Once you have the cold water currents that are running through the oceans start to get warm, you're going to have the dying of a whole bunch of fish. Salmon's going to be a delicacy, man.
Mm-hmm.
This is troubling times. What can you do? Do what inside tells. Mm-hmm. For me, inside tells, make some art. For me, it tells, scare some people a little bit with your art. Don't go the beautiful route.
Well, yeah, and you're just like processing what you process, and then people can come in, I guess.
They could take whatever they want from right. it. I mean, you know, do I want to be a dude like along with Marty standing on a soapbox like... No, like saying, you know, the world's coming to an end. No, I'm just going to say, hey, I notice Yosemite's way different 5 years time. What's it going to be 20 years time? And in that, like, so what? I have to speak my truth. There's a bravery to that, too. You know?
Well, yeah, I mean, just to draw a parallel to a time in human history where I felt that an extremely powerful, very, very sort of poignant, just maelstrom, I guess, of art came out of, but in this case, mainly in music, was the 60s.
Mm.
So if we look at what was happening then and why did that happen, well, it didn't happen in a vacuum. It had to happen as a form of resistance to something that people collectively... They formed around this kind of principle that, hey, to counteract this evil that we see perpetrated, and it was an evil that they see as a repetition of a cycle that happened every 20 years, in this case, the war, Vietnam War, but also with civil rights. It's good to be able to look back at something like that and say, well, why did so much great music come out of this one little period of time? Well, it's because something in the environment, something in sort of like the global the global condition that we all found ourselves in warranted a response, a mm-hmm. resistance response. And I think...
AKA psychedelics.
Well, no, but the psychedelics, I feel like they were the catalyst that came in and helped send that thing into flourishing. Because had they not
I
come
think
about...
I think it's what stimulated the growth
oh, it definitely of
the
did.
Entire
and that's,
generation.
Yeah, and that's why I would say that like nowadays, it's... I think to go the complacent route or to go with art just in the direction of decoration or sort of like, or I suppose like complacency, like trying to sort of just comfort people with artwork.
Mm-hmm.
It's got its place. That's fine. But I think that this time does call for a certain amount of kind of like
artist as seer.
Yeah. And art as being, once again, I guess you would say countercultural, only as it pertains to, you know, culture, if you think of it as being too comfortable. It needs to be challenged.
Right.
And I think that that's just something that I feel like stepping up to that plate and trying to do it in my own subjective way, and Sergio trying to do it in his own subjective way. It's like it's not a matter of thinking that it necessarily will even have any kind of impact on people.
Right.
But that's what brings me to the easel. It's still like I'm coming at it from that standpoint. I'm saying like I happen to have been born at a time when there's shit to be talked about and there's a lot of stuff to be spoken up against. But I don't know. You know, I don't know if that's valid or invalid, but it's just my own.
No, dude, it's totally valid.
Yeah, and I guess like to sum all that up, that's essentially what you're exploring in this body work that's at this current show. And what's the name of the show?
The Archaic Revival.
Oh, so it's named after. Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Want to plug that for a second, just to like, just in case it gets out.
Sure.
It's still up.
Yeah, it's October 1st is when it's opening, so that's tomorrow. So
tomorrow,
I'm sure
yeah.
By the time people hear this, it's come and gone. The opening was excellent.
Yeah.
Tons of fucking great people showed up. Dude, I had a good time.
Yeah.
In the future, as of now, but
it I'm runs. I'm so sorry for that thing I did.
Dude, you're already forgiven.
Okay, cool.
Even though it hasn't happened yet.
Yeah, exactly.
And it runs till October 29th. The gallery's at 521 South Anderson Street.
Yeah, it's Corey Helford Gallery.
Yeah, and I guess that's technically downtown. Is that downtown?
Yeah,
kind of. I mean, I think of downtown LA, I think of that center with the tall buildings, like the skyscraper kind of thing. But
dude, so this looks like Bushwick. It's starting to look like Bushwick.
Yeah, it's weird. It's like I guess maybe the arts district. I'll have to look on the map. But
it's got an art store.
Yeah.
It does seem like the arts district.
Dude, it's totally real.
Baltimore looks like where I came from.
Yeah. Station North Arts District and stuff like that.
Yeah. So it's just, I mean, even if my show is come and gone,
mm-hmm.
anyone listening to this should go see the space. It's
bananas.
It's cool. It's crazy.
It's huge, right?
I'm just really happy with being done with the work, having it displayed in the way that it's being displayed right now, and, life's good, man.
Yeah. Yeah, I can't wait to see it, man. And what about you? You're down here. You got something going on in Huntington, right?
Yeah. Part of the road trip was to get to Huntington Beach Art Center for mm-hmm. my opening. That happened on September 24th.
Oh, it already happened?
Yeah.
Dude.
Memento Mori, curated by Phil Roberts.
I didn't get a text about that. I mean, I guess I should have seen it, but like I didn't. That passed
I posted
me
it up
by,
on
man.
Facebook, but I'm not one to like... tell people yeah, come
I was here. I'm here.
Thanks, brother.
Well, I'll go check it out. Yeah, I'm sorry to have missed.
Well, it'll
opening.
Be up for 3 months.
Oh, okay, cool.
So it's got really great reviews from Greg Escalante, and
mm-hmm.
you know, we had a lot of really awesome people show up.
Cool.
A guy who directed my favorite movie animation, Book of Life.
Oh, cool. I haven't seen that one yet.
Yeah, George
Ramirez. Dude, you have to check it out.
It's so good. He's got some work in it.
Wow.
It got really good reviews from the LACMA curators.
Oh, great.
Yeah, like it was a great, great opening. Really good experience. And then tomorrow, my article comes out. I'm one of the features. It's like a 6 or 7 page spread on in Hi-Fructose.
Oh, congrats, man.
And thank you. Volume 41. Pick it up. You can see more about Sergio there.
Nice.
It's weird saying that because it's like, man, where was I like 1 year ago?
Wow.
You know, broken up with my fiance.
Oh, that's a whole story. We should do like a follow up to this and really get into that because there's it seemed like there's a lot going on there. Yeah. We don't have enough time to explore all that.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's totally agree.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, let's do it.
Yeah. Cool, man.
Yeah.
But
yeah, cool. So Huntington, art center? It's running for 3 months. Called what?
Yeah,
what
till November 5th. Memento Mori, Skulls and Bones. Got some really great artists. Again, great show. Amazing space. Funded by the National Endowment of the Arts.
Cool.
So the NEA, you know, did a really good job with the funding. And but yeah, you can check me out on High Fructose Volume 41, October issue. Tomorrow's October 1st.
Dope.
Yeah. So it's cool. It's, you know, like I feel like things open up when you commit.
Right.
You know, for minds like ours, man, you just got to commit. Commit to like this one thing. And you know, in the Joseph Campbellian sense, doors of the universe open in very, very weird ways to the extent that you escape burning cars. So, right. Yeah. So good.
Well, I'm glad you guys made it here safely.
Thanks, man. Yeah.
Me too. We're like mildly scathed.
Or am I really here?
Cool. Thanks, guys. I really appreciate you guys coming.
Thanks, man.
Yeah, no problem. Yeah, thanks.